Well, thank you very much for joining us here for this very special session as we discuss the crisis that the world faces when we talk about water and sanitation. Let me just throw some numbers your way before I get into the conversation with Matt and Gary and why this is such an important issue that governments around the world, the private sector, needs to grapple with. The economic health and human development impacts off the water crisis. Globally, about $260 billion in economic losses suffered every year due to the lack of safe water and sanitation. About 663 million people worldwide do not have any access to safe drinking water. 2.4 billion people worldwide do not have access to a toilet. And I think what is imperative now is for the world to understand that, like climate change, this is an issue that requires urgent intervention, whether it's from the government or the private sector, and of course, the nonprofit social sector as well. Very special guests here with me today, Matt Damon and Gary White. Thank you very much for joining us. I'm gonna give you a personal anecdote. Just before I was coming to Davos, and I told my colleagues at work, and I said, you know, I have a session with Matt Damon and Gary White, and suddenly my cool quotient went up because I was talking to Matt Damon. But I think there's a story there as well. I think we do need people who have your kind of influence to talk about these issues, because otherwise, like climate change wasn't an issue a couple of years ago, water, health, education are issues that are not given the kind of priority that they ought to. Is that what makes this sort of critical for you to put your weight behind it as well? That the world needs to address this issue?
Certainly. as I started to look at issues of extreme poverty as I wanted to get involved, a little over 10 years ago, I was just shocked by how water underpinned everything. And just the magnitude of the crisis and the senseless, needless death and not to mention leaving aside the fact that like every 90 seconds a kid is dying because they lack access to clean water and sanitation, which is something that's very hard for a Westerner to relate to at all. The life outcomes of women and girls who are spending their entire lives scavenging for water. Even if they do survive, they're doing it at the expense of their own education. The outcome they can expect in their life is severely affected by the fact that they lack access to clean water and sanitation. And so, just the scale and the magnitude of the crisis really shocked me and made me want to learn more.
Gary, you've been doing this for 25 years now. Mm-hmm. What has changed over the last 25 years? The way that governments approach this problem, the way that the social sector approaches this problem, the way that the corporate sector approaches the problem, what's been the big shift that you've seen?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the shift that we've seen, that we've acted on, and I think this gets to the point of what the insight is here, and that is that this problem actually kind of contains its own solution. The fact that the poor are already paying so much for water, 7 to 10 times more per liter than the middle class in some of the urban slums around the world. And the fact that they're going to loan sharks to take out loans to build toilets. And so you start to look at this issue in a very different way, at least we did, and that is that, what if instead of accepting the conventional wisdom that we have to raise all charity in order to solve this global crisis, what if we could look more at providing capital and getting affordable capital into the hands of the poor so that they can get the water and sanitation solutions that they need? And that's what we've done with water credits. So we had that insight and we acted on it. And now we've created a network of more than 65 microfinance institutions, 65 microfinance institutions around the world who are providing loans for water and sanitation. Now more than 5.5 million people have gained access to water and toilets by getting a loan instead of waiting for charity that might not ever come. Mm-hmm.
But you just spoke about how this problem is solvable. Give us a sense of the math, give us a sense of the numbers, because according to the WHO, what it requires about $200 billion a year, yeah. And how much have you been able to raise through water credit mm-hmm. so far?
Well, I think it's important to look at $200 billion a year versus the $8 billion that's currently going in for all aid and development assistance that and you can see that disparity and how we're never going to get there with charity. What we've done is taken philanthropic capital, about $17 million so far, to kind of jumpstart this market at the base of the pyramid, correct the market failure so that microfinance institutions can respond. So that $17 million has leveraged now $220 million in private capital to come in and scale this up. So that's really what we're looking at, and we need to scale it further. And at the macro level, I've been on the Water Global Agenda Council for WEF, and we're about to publish a report. Some of the preliminary findings show that it would take about, well, first of all, the coping costs that the poor have now of buying packaged water that's been treated, you know, the coping cost of the health issues related to this, both in terms of the direct medical cost as well as the cost of being sick and not working, premature death, all of these come up to about $678 billion a year. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, we also calculated what it would cost to get water in every household 24/7, sanitation, proper wastewater treatment. It's about $678 billion. So it's like for $4 billion, we could find our way out of this. And that's what I meant by the problem contains its own solution.
Mm-hmm. So Matt, you know, while you were speaking with investors, trying to convince them that this was an idea to bet on, this was an idea that has the potential to scale, what was the big challenge there?
Well, I think Gary's being a little humble. I think the first insight that he had was by spending his adult life in a lot of these communities, that realization that these extremely poor people were paying for their water was a big epiphany. So he had this theory that if he could just nudge the market towards them, that they could become, you know, paying customers and they could viably pay back a loan. And so it was a theory, and it's worked really better than we could have ever hoped. I mean, these loans go out and they pay back at over 99%. And what that means is, so the concept of water credit was, okay, if you live in a urban or peri-urban area, a slum, and you know you're in a slum in India, the municipality is piping water right under your feet, but you're not connected to it, mm-hmm. right? You don't have a tap in your home. So you as the woman of, you know, the matriarch of the family, you're taking time away from your job to go to some pre-designated water collection point and stand in line for, you know, however many hours to fill up your jerry can. This is obviously incredibly unproductive. So what Gary thought was, well, this isn't a classic kind of Muhammad Yunus model of an income generating loan. It's not like you're loaning me money, I'm buying a sewing machine, and I'm gonna have a sewing business and pay the loan back. But it's actually an income enhancing loan, right? Because what you're actually doing is you're buying somebody's time back. They no longer have to go. If you confront them the money for the connection to mm-hmm. the existing infrastructure, they no longer have to leave their job and spend hours waiting in line. They're going to have a tap in their house. And so you're going to buy that time back for them. And essentially what that's going to do is allow them to pay this loan off and pay it off relatively quickly. I mean, these loans, they're taken out over an 18 months to 2 year period. But oftentimes people pay them off early and immediately take out a loan to put a toilet in their house, you know. Because they've got this new income from this time that they've got back. So it started as this theory, as kind of a, Gary just looked at it and said, this really should work. And over this last number of years, it's proven to work even really as well as we ever could have hoped. And the thing about these loans paying back at 99% and above is that money just gets recycled and goes back out again. Mm-hmm. So what you're really doing is, you know, in a kind of classic direct impact situation where you're digging a well, it'll cost, say, $25 to bring somebody clean water for life. Well, with this model, because the money keeps going out and coming back and going out and coming back, in our most mature loan programs in India, we're down below $5 per person to bring them clean water for life. So you're really bringing down the philanthropic cost of capital per person, and that is what makes it sustainable and it makes it scalable.
So since you talked about India, Gary, let me ask you about the India example. Maybe that'll help us understand how the water credit model works better. Is it correct that you target largely women as far as mm-hmm. these loans are concerned? Because the delinquency ratio is significantly low, and you're almost at 99%.
Exactly. And we do, because that's our partners, right? We work through local microfinance institutions to get this done. And I think, you know, an example that kind of brings it home is a woman I met in Bangalore. She was paying for her family 20 rupees every day for their water supply, and she was paying 20 rupees so they could go use the toilet in their slum. And so, you know, every day, 40 rupees, 1,200 rupees a month that she was paying, and these are those coping costs I was, you know, getting to before. And so she took out a loan for a toilet and for a water connection, and her combined monthly payments on that loan for 18 months was 1,200 rupees. So it's exactly the same amount each month that's being expended, but she would have been trapped forever paying the 1,200 under the current system, but this access to a loan allowed her to pay that connection fee to the water utility and get the toilet built. I think that really summarizes this concept of, and Matt said it a long time ago, it's really expensive to be poor. And that's what we're helping people to do, to buy their way out of this endless cycle of going and paying for this or going to loan sharks. Another woman I met was paying 125% interest on a loan so she could build a toilet. So that's what we're trying to tap into, trying to correct this market mm-hmm. failure, basically.
You know, as you correct this market failure and as you try and scale things up, Matt, what is the role that you see of governments and the way that you can partner with governments to take this forward? For instance, in India, the government has launched a Swachh Bharat campaign, which is essentially, you know, to build toilets and sanitation and so on and so forth. How do you see the role of government in this context?
Well, that really helps put the wind at our back, actually, that Swachh Bharat mission. But look, I mean, there you really need both. You need both working and together. I mean, ours is very much a bottom-up approach, but you need that top-down services. You need governments providing the infrastructure, you know, for people to tap into. So there's a really important role for everybody to play. But I think nobody's at cross purposes. Mm. I think we're, you know, hopefully what we've been able to do is really prove this market, prove that there are these people at the base of the economic pyramid who should have value as customers, you know, and can pay that water tariff and pay it regularly and participate that way, but you know, and then there's also the issues of, well, I mean, you tell about the RBI and.
Working. You know, Matt and I have had some good meetings with the Reserve Bank of India, uh-huh. and talking about this model to offer up our experience. And one of the things that we talked about was the priority sector lending in India, and how can we support getting priority sector for water and sanitation. And talking through that, and that, you know, I'm happy to say that policy has been modified so that water and sanitation do fall under the priority sector. How can we get it into an approved vehicle for the CSR mm-hmm. Mandate that's now in India, and bringing again our experience, and you know, we're there just to support. I mean, this is a priority for India and for a lot of countries around sure. the world. And we just want to share our experience and have that factor in, however the governments think that can help them.
So it's working in India. At least the government is being responsive to the ideas that you're putting on the table. What is the experience in other developing markets that water.org is working in at this point in time? Do you see a similar sort of agility, similar responsiveness mm-hmm. from the governments that you're working with?
Yeah, we do. We do. And, you know, we're working in about 12 countries around the world. And you know, there's obviously a little bit of healthy skepticism at first, right? You know, we're this international NGO, and we have this kind of unconventional concept of water credit.
What are they sort of confused about, or what are they skeptical of?
Well, a lot of it is just that, you know, we kind of come under the radar. You know, as Matt said, we're more bottom up than top down. And so we don't kind of go in and kind of try to meet with the head minister of water or anything like that and draw attention to ourselves. What we like to do is to kind of quietly go about helping the poor get access. And what are the roadblocks that are keeping them from getting access? And we start there. We always start with the poor and see what is the roadblock. And then we help remove those roadblocks. And we find that access to affordable finance is the number one roadblock in most countries. And as we start to unpack that and develop solutions that are specific to those countries, then you know we can share our success and share our evidence base, because that's what we find governments and funders and everybody responds to best, is that we don't just have a theory. Sure. We went out and built the evidence base.
That was what was really interesting in India a couple of years ago, that our MFI partners, we asked them to identify the bottlenecks, mm-hmm. and with all of them reported back access to affordable capital. I mean, it was, they said the market is, the need is there, the appetite for these things is there. And in fact, the Gates Foundation conducted this study, and they've determined that with solutions like this, like water credit, there are 565 million people who could participate in solutions like that. So that's a big, big number. Mm. You know, if you have 660 million people who lack access to clean water and 2.4 billion who lack access to adequate sanitation, you know, 565 million, that's a healthy chunk of that can be reached with these kind of market forces, just as long as you just give the market a little nudge towards them. Mm-hmm.
So what is the aspiration? You just spoke of operating in 12 countries. Where do you see water.org in the next 5 years, Matt?
Well, we're really trying to turbocharge this idea of water credit because it's working so well. I think that's kind of our first order of business. But we also, it's about reaching people right now, but it's also about looking over the horizon and what is that next innovation? And we spend a lot of time thinking about that. For now, our latest is this idea of water equity, which is taking the concept of water credit, but now trying to involve social impact investors and people who would be willing to jump in and build a fund. So we built one fund for $11 million that we've already deployed, and now we're putting together a $50 million fund and looking for people to come in to that, just so that we can
address. When do you expect to close?
When do we expect to close?
Probably in about a little over a year. But okay. It's interesting because when we were here 3 years ago, Matt, right? You remember we announced that we had this concept. We were going to try to raise this fund. Matt kicked in the first million, and we went out and did it. We did the $11 million fund. It's been deployed into India. At least 730,000 people are going to get water, and the investors in this fund who brought the $11 million are going to get a targeted 2% financial return, and they'll get their capital back. So it's, again, the problem contains its own solution if you look at the market-based approach to this. And so now we have every confidence in announcing here that we can raise this $50 million fund. We have a pipeline of investees that's almost nearly complete that we're doing the due diligence on. And so it just, when people ask what they can do, investors, and for now it's been accredited investors coming in at very high levels so we can prove this out. But what we want to do is build a platform. In fact, we're building it now so that we can democratize this so that anybody can make a loan into water equity, and we can put that to work helping people get water, and then they can get repaid. Mm-hmm. We believe that's an inherently scalable solution if we can tap into this social impact investing phenomenon.
Well, it's a big headline. It's a big aspiration to go from $11 to $50 million, and you hope to close that by next year. But does it make life easier when you've got Matt Damon putting $1 million on the table up front? Does that help getting everybody else on board?
It certainly helps, but I think what people realize because of things like this and other things we do, Matt isn't just a celebrity, but he is literally one of the world's water experts. So there's a difference between having a celebrity show up and talk with people in government or investors. But when you have a celebrity who's like so grounded in this and really is one of the world's water experts, that has a lot of gravitas.
Well, also, I mean, just as in terms of proving this model again and again and again, it just goes to credibility for our organization going into some of these meetings. And as Bill Clinton said to us a few years ago, just keep running those numbers up. Just keep running them up. But he was right.
Well, he was right.
I mean, the more, that just builds credibility and it makes it much easier to go raise funds for something like this, for water equity, when look, people ultimately, in my experience, people really respond to things that work.
Yeah.
And I think the one takeaway that we would want everybody to have here today is that this problem is absolutely solvable. And I can't say that enough. This problem is absolutely solvable, and it's solvable in our lifetime. It's going to take a comprehensive effort from all of us, and you know, governments included. And but there's no mystery to this. We do know how to solve it.
You know, we were talking about the role that the government can play, what the social sector is doing, but what about the corporate sector and the role that you see the corporate sector playing, Gary, because you have strategic alliances in different parts of the world that you operate through. What's the experience been there, and what is the ask of the corporate sector?
Mm-hmm. Well, we've been really fortunate, and I think largely because of the market-driven aspect of the model, that we've really connected with corporate foundations. You know, the PepsiCo Foundation was a very early investor in water credit in India, and their support alone has allowed us to reach 1.6 million people in India. The IKEA Foundation, another really strong supporter of water credit, Caterpillar Foundation, Inditex, and many others have been willing to come on board with this kind of social entrepreneurial approach, mm-hmm. and back it. And so,
does it go beyond the realm of corporate social responsibility?
It does. I think it's if we look at another relationship that that we're doing with Stella Artois to engage consumers, right? And having people understand that a purchase that they make can contribute to somebody getting safe water. And so that's something that brands and corporations have a natural in, and they know how to talk to audiences. And if we can collaborate with them on the powerful messages that we see and make that happen, then that kind of democratization, again, whether it's making a donation to water.org or making a purchase or making a loan when that platform is ready, there's lots of ways that corporations and water.org and water equity can partner. And I think that's the key. This is all about partnerships, whether it be with the governments, whether it be with our corporate supporters, or whether it be with individuals.
Well, one of the things I'm really excited to see with this Stella deal, where it goes, is they have a few different ways you can give. They have these chalices that are these beautiful glass mm-hmm. chalices that are designed by artists in the countries in which we're operating. So you can buy those chalices, and then but you can also do things like go into a pub in the UK or America and buy a pint of Stella, and that one pint of Stella, they will guarantee bringing someone in the developing world clean water for a month. So I'm curious to see, and I asked them.
Feel good about drinking yourself to death.
You don't have to order 50 of them. I mean,
that's not so bad, though.
Yeah, that might not be so bad. But no. So, I mean, if I were, a college kid or 25 years old, and said, well, I can have my favorite beer, and I'm also doing, I'm really interested to see.
Were you really thinking that way at 25?
Well, here's the thing. I think this generation, the millennials, are,
yeah,
and both anecdotally, and then also, I mean, we were talking to Stella earlier, and they were saying it's quantifiable, right? Because this generation coming up is tuned into stuff like this in a way that Generation X, my generation, was totally tuned out.
What were you thinking of at 25?
I was just thinking about my acting career, I think, and writing screenplays. But what's exciting is to look at this younger generation coming behind us, because they really do get it. And if our corporate partners can show an increase in their bottom line, mm-hmm. by an activation like this, that's really great news for all of us, because we'll be able to bring more brands into this and really kind of turbocharge our work. That would be wonderful.
Since you're talking about turbocharging, and you just gave us the Stella example, is this B2C engagement going to be something that you want to focus on over the next few years to really scale things up?
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah? Yeah.
I mean, I think anything we can do to scale this up, and as President Clinton says, run the numbers up. I think that's what we'll be focused on.
How important is it going to be for individual brands to collaborate with you in order for you to get the kind of scale that you require, Gary?
Well, I think that's just it. I mean, in the conversations that we had with Stella, it's like we want to expand this type of partnership and get more partners. This is an all hands on deck kind of global crisis that we need to solve. So it is. Corporations have really evolved over the last couple of decades or so to play kind of an outsized role on the global stage, right? 30 years ago, governments would have dominated conversations like this, and now corporations are coming into it. And I think that the corporate social responsibility that's incumbent upon them to look at issues through this framework, whether it be because they know that they have consumers in these countries and it's important to them to help people there meet these basic needs, or whether it is something that can also, their stewardship of and support of issues like this can help the bottom line. So I think we have to rally them to reach the more democratized mm-hmm. audience. And so, people can still make donations to kind of jumpstart these innovations and markets. And then hopefully we can even work with some of these brands to figure out how to democratize the loan program so people can make loans, and maybe we can tie that in with some brand partners.
So Matt, is the focus going to continue to be over the next few years really on democratizing or addressing this challenge through access to finance? Or are you also looking at other innovations, specifically using technology to provide access to water?
Well, we'll keep doing what what we've been doing really successfully with these financial models. Without a doubt, we're always looking for the next thing. So it's a two-pronged approach.
What could be the next big idea?
That's always the question. You know what I mean? And so we have a whole new ventures fund where part of what we do is take these ideas and pilot them and see see what actually works. We kind of very much like water credit. Had we not tested it in the real world and put real resources, it would have just been a theory. So, mm-hmm. So as of now, we know that there's this low-hanging fruit where there's this appetite, there's this demand for these loans. So we're just trying to get as many of these loans out as we can, because that's a very tangible way to run the numbers up.
Yeah, and I think that the New Ventures Fund that you referenced, that New Ventures Fund is a pool of philanthropic capital that we've raised that help us to do R&D, basically. You just don't think of NGOs as having an R&D fund, and yet many NGOs need that, if not all. Corporates have that. And so we wouldn't have been able to discover some of these insights, and shape the solutions unless we had that support. And I think that as we move forward, that's going to continue to be our innovation engine. A great example of that we're tapping into with water equity and water credit is what if we wanted to go beyond microfinance? Mm. We don't necessarily believe that we're going to get water to everybody through microfinance institutions. There are lots of other enterprises out there that are struggling, that are trying to serve the base of the pyramid needs of water and sanitation, either through designing and bringing to market low-cost toilets, mm-hmm. The supply chains for the pipes and the other infrastructure that needs to go in, and people selling and manufacturing water filters to treat water. So with water equity, that fund will actually have a 10% carve out of that $50 million that will be for these frontier investments, so that we can test providing capital to these other types of enterprises that are serving the base of the pyramid needs. So, and that's kind of what's next, I think, for us.
Any exciting pilot projects that you want to run us?
Well, I was just in Cambodia just a few weeks ago, and I met some of these private water utilities. They get these concessions from the government to supply water to these areas that are more outlying. And people that are really committed to serving the needs of the poor there that are starved for capital. So they have the water treatment plant, they have some infrastructure, but they want to spread the infrastructure out to more users. But they're so capital constrained. I've talked to utilities in Africa that were paying 33% for capital. Imagine a utility in the U.S. issuing a bond mm-hmm. for 33%. You just can't make it happen. So we're looking at these small utilities. And again, they're regulated by the government. They have to charge fair rates. But if we can get them the capital that they need, they could double the number of people living in poverty that could get access to a water connection.
Mm-hmm. What about the infrastructure deficit? And a lot of these countries that you work in, countries like India, Cambodia, et cetera, there is that infrastructure deficit, which is the big elephant in the room that you have to deal with. You're trying to address the access to finance problem, but do you see the infrastructure deficit as being the big stumbling block?
Well, look, there are some people for whom only a subsidy-driven model will work, right? But our argument is that it's not this entire pyramid that everybody, you know, that there's market segmentation, right? And that there, you know, and there's a huge swath that you can reach with this finance model, right? But if you go to rural Ethiopia, and yeah, I mean, there's nobody's going to put pipes out there, you know, but you know, and for some people, we would just argue a much smaller percent of that at the base of the economic period, a subsidy-driven model would really be your only solution.
So, Gary, how do you address that? If no one wants to go down to Ethiopia and put pipes down, how do you, in that sense, get to the 663 million people?
Yeah, because our vision is that we can be the generation that solves the water crisis, and that means everyone. I think when you kind of unpack the economic pyramid, you recognize that there's, you know, literally hundreds of millions of people who could get their solution through things like finance, but then there's the extreme poor, and that's where the subsidy model comes in. It is the responsibility of governments to provide that infrastructure, even if it is in extremely rural areas. Now, that's not piped water to every house, but it's a well-maintained, safe water pump that's covered, that people can then walk a reasonable distance to get access to water. So I think that there are a variety of solutions that allow us to get this done. But the concept is we've got to get past this conventional wisdom that it's going to take charity to solve it for everyone. If we can take the funds that would have otherwise been directed to those who can afford to pay, you know, those philanthropic funds could be redirected from there to people who really need that subsidy, then I think it's going to be a much more solvable problem.
You know, so for people sitting in this room, if they want to get involved, if they want to contribute in some way, what would you say, Matt? You know, what should they be doing? What should they be thinking of?
To drink Stella beer.
Yes, besides starting to drink. I'm going to grab one right after this, by the way.
Well, you can always go to water.org. That's and make a donation. You know, and follow our work. And I mean, I can say as somebody who's been doing this for a little while that it is one of the most complex and fascinating problems facing our world, and it's really, really interesting. And so you can just maybe start doing a deeper dive at our website and start learning more about it. I can only promise you it's endlessly fascinating, but that would be a good place to start.
Gary?
Yeah, I think, you know, becoming more aware of this issue, you know, like Matt says, it's certainly we still need philanthropic support in order to correct these market failures and discover the new innovations. So we like people to donate to water.org so we can discover the next big thing. But then also once we get our platform up, I think engaging by making a loan and kind of following how that has impact in sharing it with other people. That's one of the things that I hope that platform can do. You know, I can imagine once we get that up, somebody could gift you know, their family or friend for the holidays alone, you know, that then they can track. And you know, that our market research and our hope is that once people do that, even though they have the opportunity to take their money out after that first loan and get repaid, that they'll continue to reinvest it and help more people get access to
water. What's the average loan size, just so that everyone can plan their holiday gifting ideas?
It's about $217 now.
$217.
Roughly.
Roughly, okay. Okay. All right, I'm going to throw this open for questions. I can see lots of hands here. Yes, the lady in the... Yes, right. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Mariana Aguilar. I'm a global shaper from the Cordoba Hub in Argentina. And I wanted to ask you about the role of youth. We talked briefly about the role of government and corporate sector and about the Stella challenge, which I can accept.
You've got a lot of people accepting the Stella challenge.
Actually, I have two of the glasses back home. So I wanted to ask you if you think that the involvement of youth in the solution, not just buying beer, but actually the solution, it's important to solving this problem. And if so, if water.org does have a strategy to actually involve youth in these communities to work on water access projects. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Great question. That next generation is absolutely critical to us. And I mean, just look at the just look at how empowered you guys are to shape the behavior of these corporations, not only your respective governments, but also these corporations. I mean, you've got these big corporations like paying attention to their consumer base, and if their consumer base lets them know that these issues are important to them, you'll activate that corporation, and it'll be this kind of virtuous circle where the corporation, where say someone like Stella Artois, we want their bottom line to be affected. We really hope that their customer base goes, you know what, I like to go to the pub on Friday night, and I was going to order, but I'm going to order this type of beer because this is actually going to make a difference in somebody's life. And so I think you wield a huge amount of power, and everybody's watching what you guys do.
Yeah, and I think the shapers, the social entrepreneurs that are here. I'm a Schwab social entrepreneur and a Skoll social entrepreneur. So I completely get the power of ideas that are out there among those communities, and I think never has it been easier to kind of activate around an idea. And I think for us, first of all, we see a lot of individuals that are already coming into solving this problem, either through organizations that they create or working in some of these partners that we work with around the country, the nationals of those countries that work in these microfinance institutions that are open to new ideas, hopefully the shapers and the entrepreneurs and others who are starting these enterprises that maybe need capital from water equity and could be funded with an investment in that way. So I think that's critical. I mean, we're in the business of ideas. I mean, that's, water equity is an innovation of water.org, and it's going to be a spinoff into its own entity. And so we value those kinds of game-changing ideas.
Gary, I'm glad that you talked about social entrepreneurship. And, we've been partnering in India with the Schwab Foundation for the Social Entrepreneur Awards for the last 15-odd years now. And, as someone who's been doing this now for 25 years, you've been a social entrepreneur, what is the message that you would like to give to other young entrepreneurs who are looking at social entrepreneurship specifically?
I think what I would say is that really if you feel drawn to an issue and you feel like you have a key insight, then I think that's the first step. I think, and it has to be your passion. The saying that I love, it's, your life should be about finding the intersection of your greatest passion and the world's greatest need. So there hasn't been a social entrepreneur yet who succeeded, who didn't have like great passion about the issue that they're working on. But that's not enough. You have to really test your idea to the insight that you have to make sure that somebody else isn't doing it, right? Don't be afraid to grab onto others that maybe have pioneered something that you can come in and kind of nudge one way or the other. You don't necessarily have to create an organization whole cloth.
Water credit's a great example of that.
Yeah, water credit is just nudging a system that's already there, and that can be hugely beneficial. And I think that once you get that insight, then you have to build the evidence base to debunk the conventional wisdom so that you can then have that evidence base to go find the funding to scale up, because all social entrepreneurs need that access to capital as well to scale their ideas.
What's been the hardest part of being a social entrepreneur?
That's been hardest. I don't know. I would probably have to say not being certain of the future that you envision. And I think one of my greatest fears was that I might give up, right? But I didn't, and I think you're inherently an optimist, because if you had told me it was going to take as long to get to where I am today, I might not have started, but I was always convincing myself it would happen much faster. I mean, 25 years, you'd think we'd have the global water crisis solved by now, right? It's a humbling experience to see that not everybody is going to see in the same way the insight and the change that you're trying to bring about. But if you believe deeply enough in it, you just have to keep pushing.
Mm-hmm. More questions? Yes, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Jaideep Bansal. I'm a global shaper from Chandigarh in India. And I'm involved in the electrification of the remotest villages in the Himalayas, people who have never seen what a light bulb is, We provide them energy access using solar microgrids. Mm. My question to you is, where do you see the innovation in clean drinking water technology coming from? Is it a more push from the governments, or is it the private sector, or nobody cares about the innovation?
Mm. Well, we hope somebody does care about the innovation.
Go ahead.
I have no doubt that there are going to be technologies that emerge that'll be game changers in this, and I'm not averse to technology. I have 3 engineering degrees myself, right? But what I find is that the innovations that need to happen and need to be more around finance at this point, right? Because there's already water being treated somewhere, especially in the urban and peri-urban areas, and getting into pipes. And that technology hasn't changed a whole lot in the last 100 years. But we get people coming to us all the time that have the silver bullet idea of the technology, and largely we find that when you do the numbers on it, it's still too expensive to really serve the base of the pyramid where we're looking at. That doesn't mean that we're going to be indifferent to this. We'll continue to look at those and see if there are ones that can truly be game changers. But for now, it really seems to be leveling the playing field for the poor, getting them access to the same water supply system that the middle class and the wealthy have in these areas.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Oluwaseun Daniel, a global shaper from Abuja Hub in Nigeria. And my question is, what role does education play in maintaining this access? Because from my experience, taps, water filters, even toilets, they break down. So what role does water.org play in ensuring that this access lasts a lifetime?
Mm-hmm. Great question, because I think the statistic is that half of all water projects worldwide fail. Mm-hmm. and I remember, speaking of wasting water. I remember being in Ethiopia with Gary 7 years ago or 8 years ago, and there was, we were in this very rural area, and there was a hand-dug well that the water literally was the color of chocolate milk. It was just so dirty, and these children were filling up these 2-liter bottles to take them to school, you know, and it was very hard to watch, you know, because you knew there was very high degree of certainty that they were going to get sick, but they needed to have water to survive. And about 20 meters from this hand-dug well that this whole village was using, there was this state-of-the-art hand pump that was just gathering dust. And it had come from an Indian NGO, and it was probably a $10,000 pump, but, you know, as in many of these cases, it had been put in and left. And so when it broke down or needed some part, obviously there was no hardware store around with this part. So mm-hmm. it just kind of went to seed and just sat mm-hmm. there. And so you see a lot of that, a lot of these direct impact programming that isn't really quite thought out and doesn't really get enough community buy-in from the community it's meant to serve. You know, and a big part of that is, you know, is educating the people who are going to run it on how to use it and how to fix it, and you know, that's just something you see over and over again, is this issue of really well-intended efforts that kind of aren't thought through all the way.
Yeah, and I think that it's that collaboration between the community itself, who has to be equipped to be able to do that basic maintenance, but then also backstopped by government, where more expensive repairs are needed. So it's a bottom up and top down that everybody has that goal of maintaining the infrastructure once it's in place. I think the important thing also about water credit and the fact that we're taking this market driven approach, and that so many of these infrastructure projects are just gifted to people, right, without consulting them about, is this the toilet that they want? Is this the hand pump that's best for them? Mm-hmm. Does this best meet their needs? Do they want just a latrine with like some some bamboo wrapper around it,
sure,
for privacy? Or do they want an improved toilet with concrete blocks, and are they willing to pay for that? So the key with water credit is that nobody is going to take out a loan for a water sanitation solution that's not right for them.
Right.
So it almost makes this inherently sustainable, the fact that people are getting the solutions that they want, they're invested in it, they'll maintain it, and then they also can also stage this. A lot of people will take out a loan for a simple toilet, and then they'll come back and take out another loan to have a bathing area next to it. So it allows them, and this is so important, it allows them the dignity and the power to be able to get the solutions that are going to best meet their needs. And I think that goes a long way towards the sustainability issue that the sector faces.
So they're customizing their solutions themselves. Yeah. I have 2 minutes of the last question. I give that side two chances. So yes, go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Carla Delantar. I'm a global shaper from the Cebuav in the Philippines. I run a nonprofit as well. I'm the country director for Waves for Water, so we provide access to clean drinking water in the most remote locations in the Philippines. So we've been talking points on technological advances. We're talking about the proof of concept. It's already working. So with our mission to actually providing access to clean drinking water and all around the world, my question is, how does this delay if climate change is a big issue nowadays?
You've got 30 seconds.
How it relates to climate change is the question. Yeah. Well, it's yet to be fully seen. I think that any time that you have, with climate change, you're going to have shifting weather patterns, and you're going to have too much precipitation in one place and not enough in another, and that's going to cause dislocations in all kinds of ways. I think flooding that's going to contaminate wells. Mm-hmm. When you get all this runoff with fecal matter, around, that contaminates wells. Rising sea levels going to cause wells that would otherwise produce fresh water to be producing salt water for people. So it really is going to run the gamut. I think what we can be most certain of is that it's going to disproportionately affect the poor, because they're the ones that always seem to not have the resources to cope with these things. And I think that kind of brings me back around to just what we're seeing, I think, emerging in this annual meeting is how important income disparity is, and we have to wake up to that. The New York Times article yesterday, the six wealthiest people now controlling half of the world's wealth, or more than, equaling the bottom half.
Equaling
the bottom half, yeah. But to me, there's no greater manifestation of that than water, right? Because if you are poor, nothing else matters except getting water today. And nothing else exemplifies that disparity more than us having access to water without even thinking about it, and this bottom half not having it at all. And to me, this is what income disparity is all about and why we need to tackle it. And again, knowing that it's inherently solvable.
Gary Veith, thank you very much for your optimism, and thank you very much for waging this battle for 25 years. Matt Damon, you've inspired everyone in this room to go out there and get a Stella. But what about proceeds from the next Matt Damon movie? Can we see proceeds being used? Can we see proceeds being used to try and solve this crisis?
Well, that you have to take up with the studio. I don't know. I don't know how receptive they'll be to that. But the consumers have a lot of power with what they spend their movie tickets on too. So who knows? Maybe there's a way to bake it into some of that too.
Matt Damon, Gary Veith, thank you very much for joining us here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right.
All right.